Greetings, adventurers, and welcome back to Abnormal Voyages. My name is David, and today we're in the Great Smoky Mountains, here in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Of course, you can't talk about the mountains, or Tennessee, without talking about moonshine. We are at the Sugarland Shine Distillery to get a taste of that wonderful stuff. Come tag along.
We're going to a place that you've never heard of before.
It's
Sugarlands Distilling opened this location in March of 2014 and has been a massive hit ever since. Brewing up authentic moonshine and offering tours and tastings, no trip to Gatlinburg is complete without a stop to Sugarlands. Once you sign up for a tasting, you get a nice little menu here that shows you exactly what it is that you're about to try. And of course, we had to try every single one.
Hey, Josh!
Don't worry about your tags blowing all over the place. That shit, that's fine. So if you need something, just holler at Josh. I'll help you out. I've only got one rule, we'll get going. You're not allowed to share your samples. That's a Gatlinburg City rule. If I catch you sharing, I'm supposed to cut you off, alright? You guys are grown ass adults. Drinking out of cups this big. You don't need to share it, so don't do that, alright? So, first one is moonshine, flavored moonshine. It's called Silver Cloud. It's 100 proof. There's corn and sugar. Please don't smell it. It smells awful. And don't sip it if you don't like the first sip. Hey, cheers, guys.
Alright, moonshine, flavored moonshine.
And you get down, breathe out. It helps a little bit.
Tastes like moonshine.
Hazelnut rum.
Appalachian apple pie. That one's really sweet.
American peach. That's just peachy. Peach margarita.
That one's really good.
Not bad.
Kind of sour too. Sweet tea. Being from Texas, this has to be good, right? Yep, that's pretty good. Wild Mayo. It's all right.
Punch. Tastes just like high C.
Peanut butter and jelly. That's really good.
Butterscotch gold. Delicious. That's good. The old classic, root beer. Tastes just like it. Fantastic.
Butter pecan, cream liqueur. That was really good. Real thick. Pretty good.
Banana pudding.
Definitely a banana. But
going
it's good.
Bananas for that one. That is
good.
Finger licking good.
It's good.
In my opinion, they totally saved the best for last. The banana pudding was amazing. But, despite having those flavors, there are still many, many other varieties that you can purchase here at Sugarlands. It would have been great to sample every single flavor, but I have a feeling that would leave people too tipsy to walk out the door if they did that. Banana pudding, of course, has a huge section on the wall here. Seems a lot of people agree with me that it's good. The peanut butter and jelly's popular. I guess those unique flavors really call out. Blueberry muffin is one we didn't get to try. Neither was maple bacon, but that one certainly seems to be flying off the shelf. Root beer was a popular option, as well as their peppermint offering. It was just amazing that they could get this many different flavors out of the same alcohol. It kind of reminds me of the same way that vodka comes in a lot of different flavors, but in my opinion, moonshine tastes way better than any vodka. The gift shop section was really great as well. They had their logo on there, and lots of different moonshine puns and catchy sayings. You could grab yourself a shirt, a hat, special shot glasses, pretty much anything you would want to help heighten your moonshine experience. You could find it right here. I love you to the moonshine and back. That was probably my favorite logo. Surprisingly, the moonshine bottles were actually very reasonably priced as well. You would think, kind of in a touristy area, they could get away with having to be up a little bit more, but they weren't taking advantage of that. You got a fair price for a really good product. Now, usually, Sugarlands also offers a behind-the-scenes tour where you get to see how the distillery actually runs. However, that was on hold during the pandemic just for health and safety concerns. That's certainly something that we're going to be back to check out soon. With the moonshine tasted, there was another famous alcohol that we just had to check out while we were in Tennessee.
Of course, being in Tennessee, we couldn't leave without stopping by to see our friend Jack Daniel and pay our respects.
That's right, Jack Daniel's and his old number 7 Tennessee whiskey, one of the most famous in the world. As soon as we found out that we could actually visit the distillery and see the process of how this world-famous alcohol was made, we knew we had to stop by and check it out.
We begin our tour in this wonderful museum that tells us a little bit about Jack's life and how he came to make that delicious whiskey.
Jack Daniel established the Jack Daniel Distillery here in Lynchburg, Tennessee in 1866. This date makes it the very first registered distillery within the United States. The weight of all the years that Jack Daniel's has been around really hits you when you see this timeline of bottles throughout the centuries that show what the old number 7 used to come in. It's fascinating getting to see the different types and the ways that this same product has been marketed throughout the years. Some of the bottles even have whiskey still inside, never being opened. Talk about aged. Of particular interest is the fact that even though they bottled and made whiskey, they managed to survive even through Prohibition, when whiskey was definitely not something you could legally sell. As famous and world-renowned as Jack Daniel's whiskey is, this is still the one and only place it's made on the entire planet. Whether you pick up a bottle in Texas, New York, Mexico, or even Australia, this is where it was lovingly made and bottled. Though centuries have gone by since Jack Daniel began this experiment with whiskey, the way it's made here at the distillery is still exactly the same as the foundations that he set so very long ago. There were numerous artifacts and memorabilia that came from the different time spans that the distillery had been around, and lots of things that just showed the way that Jack Daniel's had become a cultural phenomenon and the way that it impacted the world around it. There was also, of course, a couple pieces of his iconic outfit, including two of his hats. Very snazzy dresser. Old Number 7 is, of course, the iconic whiskey that has been around as long as Jack Daniel Distillery. And though Jack Daniel had many female friends, he never married or had any children. That would cause him to eventually, on his death, will away the entire distillery to his nephew. This was my favorite part of the museum section, where you got to see a dissected barrel and see what it actually looked like on the inside. A little later on, they would show us more about how they actually create these barrels here at the distillery. There were some honorary posthumous degrees that had been awarded to Mr. Jack Daniel. And a great collection of photographs that gave you a little glimpse into the life and day-to-day operations when Jack Daniel was still around running the distillery. But soon, it was time to leave the museum, board a little van, and head out to the other parts of the distillery where we could actually see the process firsthand. Our first stop was seeing the creation of their signature charcoal. Pallets of hard sugar maple are doused in raw, unaged whiskey and then set ablaze. The fire peaks at 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit before it burns down to smoldering embers. In a process that takes 3 to 5 days to complete, every single drop of whiskey will filter through this charcoal and be transformed with that unique and blessed flavor. This process was actually invented by Jack Daniel himself and has been in use here ever since the beginning. Here's an example of how it looks once the blaze is put out. Of course, working so closely with flames, it makes sense to have a few safety precautions. This is one of the old-fashioned fire trucks they had, just in case any flames got out of hand.
Actually the source of water for all whiskey made here at Jack Daniel's.
The mineral-rich spring waters from this cave are actually the reason that the distillery is where it is. Jack Daniel discovered this cave and the water flowing from within, and it became one of the most crucial components of every drop of Jack Daniel whiskey. They continue the tradition by only using this water to this very day. With a historical marker right on the wall, another location you get to visit is Jack Daniel's very own home where he lived here at the distillery. You get to see a few of the main ingredients of the whiskey, and also on display is the safe that actually took his life. Jack Daniel kicked it one day in frustration and got an injury on his toe that soon developed into gangrene and eventually killed him. Here was a nice picture of Jack with his original crew. And then it was off to explore more sections of the distillery. We had the grain mill here, where all the grains, of course, are kept. The iconic looking still house. This is where a lot of the day-to-day mixing and settling and perfection of the whiskey happens before it's later gone through the charcoal and stored in the barrels for the aging process. We moved on to a short film about the process of creating the iconic Jack Daniel's barrels. And, of course, where the bottling takes place, and all that whiskey is sealed up to be sent out to people all over the world. Most exciting was the barrel house, where not only lots of whiskey lay aging, but also was waiting for us to give it a try. A little more refined than the Sugarlands moonshine tasting, here at Jack Daniel's, they set up a nice menu for you, where you would be tasting five of their top-of-the-line premium offerings.
Number 27, Gold.
Sinatra Select. Good.
This is the single barrel
so
select.
Last time there was a set of twins, dude. It's my cousin, and none of us have had it before.
It's got a very nice warming cover in here.
I have a child.
Very nice.
Single barrel. Barrel proof.
And our last one, single barrel rye. Goes down very smooth. Very nice.
And they round it out by having a nice display of the whiskeys that you just tasted. Very nice glory shots there of everything, just so you can be like, hey, I drank that. At the end of your tour, you are dropped off at what they call the bottle shop. As it is a dry county, they can't technically sell you alcohol, so what you're buying is the bottle. The alcohol inside just happens to come along with it. However, if you're really looking for Jack Daniel's swag, you're gonna drive down the street to their actual gift shop, which is in an old hardware store. During Prohibition times, one of the things they did to keep the company afloat was opening this local hardware store and getting sales through here. Of course, once whiskey was back in business, they had this big store and didn't know what to do with it. So why not turn it into a great place to pick up all your favorite Jack Daniel's swag? From shirts, to chairs, to hats, to shot glasses, anything and everything you could ever want with Jack Daniel's, with Old Number 7, anything whiskey related, this was your heaven. This is where it came from. This is the only place you needed to be to get it all. And I mean, who doesn't want a Jack Daniel's branded jukebox? That is just what your house needs. This Lynchburg chess set was really cool. Of course, Jack Daniel is the king there, but I actually liked that the safe that ended up killing him was one of the pieces. I'm not sure what that says about them, but it's a snazzy chess set. But in my opinion, the most unusual and coolest thing you could buy here was in the barrel shop. That's right, for just a couple $100, you could bring home a used Jack Daniel's Old Number 7 Tennessee whiskey barrel of your very own. Now, what exactly you would do at home with this barrel is completely up to you. You could make a table out of it. I guess you could sit on them. They could just look good in the corner. Either way, very cool, very unique. Ultimately, Jack Daniel created what so many people wish they could, a legacy. It's well alive here in Lynchburg and all around the world. Well, my name is David, and this has been Abnormal Voyages. Thanks for tagging along. We'll see you next week.